Everyone, in this review note, I'll be demonstrating how to install Windows Server 2012 into a VM running on VMware Player. Let's get started. It'll launch VMware Player. And we're going to create a new virtual machine. Start by specifying the ISO image for Server 2012 I'm going to use for that installation. Here is my ISO here. Select that. You'll notice that there's a message that comes back that VMware Player knows that we're going to install Server 2012 because of the contents of the ISO image. We need to give the virtual machine a name. I'm going to call this Server 01. That's the name of the VM, not the host name of the OS. Also going to modify my path so that it is going to be stored on my SSD. You'll notice that at the end of the path, there's a folder name that matches the VM name. It's a good idea, good practice, if you allow the system to store the files associated to the VM in a folder that matches the VM's name. Makes things a lot easier for us to manage that way. We need to specify the size of the virtual disk. Typically, VMware is going to make a pretty reasonable assumption on the size the disk needs to be based on the type of OS. The one thing I am going to change is I'm going to have the virtual disk stored as a single file as opposed to multiple smaller files. In the older days, transporting around a single large file was a bit challenging. These days, not so much. So we'll make that one big file. What that essentially means is that if we utilize enough of the disk space on our server, it could actually grow out to be a file of 60 gigabytes in size. And if we needed to move this at some point in the future, we'd actually have to move a 60 gigabyte file. And we're essentially ready to go. We'll create the VM and by default power on the virtual machine. You know, hold at this point, I want to go into customize hardware and point out a few things. One single virtual processor, fine for our purposes. You can change that if you wish. Same thing with memory, 2 gigabytes. That's going to be fine for our purposes. You can change that if you wish as well. We have a network adapter that is connected to the NAT network. Again, for us, that's going to be fine. And the rest of these items I'm not really going to worry about. I'll say go ahead and close that, and I will finish, which means that the VM is going to be created and then powered up. Now, I don't want it to power on automatically. I'll deselect that and finish, and we'll see here is that VM that's been created. There's nothing wrong with powering it on. I simply wanted to point out how the VM gets created. We can now change the settings if there was something in hardware we wanted to modify. If not, we can select play the virtual machine here. There's another button at the top, which is the same thing. That will power on the VM and it's going to start to install Windows Server. I'll go ahead and power that up. We'll see a couple of messages come past and then we'll be in a position that we'll be starting to install the OS. You can see that it's starting to boot Windows at this point in time. First thing it's going to pop up with is a screen that's going to ask us about the environment. So we're going to have to specify the language, keyboard layout, the type of thing that if you've installed Windows before, you'll have seen with other Microsoft operating systems. Here's our prompt, as I was mentioning. We're not going to change anything here. This is all fine for us. And we now have an opportunity to actually start the installation. The other option is repair if we have a problem installation and we need to try and fix that somehow. So you go ahead and install. And it will have a couple more items it's going to need to know from us before it actually goes and does the installation. First thing is, what edition of the software are we going to install? And with Windows Server 2012, we've got a few different options. One is standard versus data center. It simply means how many virtual instances are we going to be able to run under the license. Feature-wise, they're identical. We also have either server core or server with GUI. Core simply means that there will be no GUI. Everything is from command prompt. For the work that we're going to be doing in the lab, we're going to need a GUI. So we'll select the second item down and tell it to go ahead and start with the installation. Have to accept the license agreement, of course. And we've got an opportunity to either upgrade or create a ground up or a custom installation. We don't have an installation currently, so we can't upgrade it. Therefore, custom is going to be the one we want. And then last thing, where are we going to install? In this case, there is only one disk. We don't have the option of really selecting anything else. I'll simply say next, and the installation will now start. We have to copy some files over, do some configuration things. System's going to reboot. No sense sitting around with the video running for the next several minutes while that happens, so I'm going to pause and I'll come back when we're prompted for some more information. Back in a few minutes. Okay, we're back from that. System's rebooted, gone through some setup. It's now prompting for a password for the administrator account. Put that in, and we're ready to log in. That's pretty much it as far as the installation is concerned. Next step is going to be actually doing post-installation configuration. First thing I need to do is log in by hitting this button that's going to send Control-Alt-Delete. We'll put in our administrative password and wait for the system to come up. Once we're logged in successfully, which we are now, one of the first things we'll see come up is going to be the Server Manager configuration console. And once that's up, we'll start doing some base configuration on our system. One of the things that we're going to be prompted for is, from a networking perspective, do we want to enable on our server going out and hunting around on the network for resources? We do not want to do that, so I will say no. We can see the server manager is launching and is now up on our screen. The first thing I want to do as far as configuration is concerned is install VMware Tools, and we're also going to change the host name. The reason I'm going to do both of those at the same time is they require a reboot. So I can do both of those, reboot once, and then save myself a reboot afterwards. To install VMware Tools, I'll launch that first because it takes a little bit longer. Go up to Player, Manage, and Install VMware Tools. As soon as I hit that, it is going to mount the ISO image that will install VMware Tools. We'll see that pop up here. I'll click on that, say that I want to run the setup. We'll give this a minute until the setup comes up and we can answer the prompts. So we'll go off and do the installation, and then we will change the host name. Okay, so here's our prompt on the screen. I'm going to take all the defaults and do a typical installation, and it will go and take care of all of that for us. Now, back here in Server Manager, I'm going to select local server, which will give us a bunch of properties associated to this installation. And the one I want to focus on right now is the computer name, which is one that's going to be chosen and generated by the installation setup. It's going to select your click on the computer name. It will pop up our system properties. Pardon the screen going black for there for a second. That's part of the VMware Tools installation while it probes the video adapter. It'll come back to us in a second here. All right, there, that's back. It's going to click on change. And a good practice is to make sure the host name matches the VM name. So our VM name is server01, and change the host name to match that. And I will say okay for that. The system will now probe out onto the network to find out if there's a duplicate host name. As long as it doesn't find one, it will tell us that we're ready to go. It's prompting that we need to restart to apply the changes, meaning that the host name that we've selected is fine. I'll say okay for that. I'll close this and we'll see that it's prompting to restart now. Our VMware Tools installation should be complete. Okay. So I'll tell it that it is okay to restart. VMware Tools setup is back. So it says we need to finish. Do I want to restart? So I've got restart prompts now from two different things. One from VMware Tools and then one from changing the host name. I'll pick this guy and say restart. It's going to go through and do a reboot. That'll be back in a couple seconds, and then we can go on and finish our post-installation config. Okay, that's back. One of the nice things I can do with VMware Tools is I can now maximize my VM window, and you'll notice that it automatically expands to fill all the space. Something you need VMware Tools to do, but it's actually quite nice from that perspective. I'll log back in again as administrator. And then once Server Manager's back up, we'll look at those few other things that we have to do from a post-installation configuration perspective. All right, so Server Manager is up. I'm going to once again pick on local server. And we'll look at a few of the other items or properties that we're going to want to change. One of them is going to be our time zone. I will select that and change time zone. Set this to Eastern Time. And OK and OK from that. Time zone set is going to be fairly important when later on we work with other software that is going to be time sensitive from authentication, that type of a thing. We see that this hasn't changed immediately. Like with anything, if I do a refresh, then whatever settings we modified will come up. A couple of other things. One is I'm going to want to enable remote desktop. I can't do that right now because we're in the public firewall zone and remote desktop is not usable in that space. So I'm going to change this first. And to do that, I need to use PowerShell. Pop up PowerShell. One of the things I need to do is look at my network connection. Commandlet is get net connection profile. So I just did get netcon and tab, which will do tab completion. Hit enter. I only have one network adapter, which is this guy here. And what I want to do is change this network category from public to private. The way I do that is set net connection profile. I have to specify the adapter that I want. I can do that either through interface alias or name. So if I do dash name and network. And then what I want to do is change the network category. And if I do dash net and hit tab, it's going to auto expand to category. And I'm going to change that to private. And that's all I have to do for that. So once we've changed that to private, I'll just refresh this again. We can see that this is private and we can now enable remote desktop. Come into that. We can see the remote desktop is not enabled at this point in time. I can click on allow. I get a prompt that asks me if it's okay for the ports to be open on the firewall for remote desktop. Yes, that's fine. It's automatically done for me. And then the checkbox that's down on the bottom basically sets the level of security for remote desktop. If I'm only going to be using Microsoft's remote desktop software from Windows 7 Server 2008 and later, I can leave this checked and I'm going to get the highest level of security. If I want to use some third-party tools for remote desktop, I need to clear this because Microsoft essentially has protected the capability for that. And I am going to be using some of those tools, so I'm going to clear that checkbox. Okay. If I do a refresh, we can now see that remote desktop is enabled. I also want to be able to ping this machine, and Microsoft by default blocks inbound pings on IPv4 with the firewall. Make a change to that. I'm going to select on the firewall. Firewall config will come up. I'm going to select advanced settings. And once that comes up, I'm going to look at my inbound rules. When I choose that, the only thing I have to do now is enable the rule. And this might look a wee bit weird, but the actual rule is file and printer sharing and echo request ICMPv4 in. All I have to do is right click on that and enable the rule. I'll just come down here to a different one. We can see that this is now enabled, and that will allow inbound pings on my system. Close out the firewall config. That's a wrap for the video. Hopefully this is helpful, and we'll see you next time.